Good morning. Okay, so this has been Thanksgiving week, and I can tell some of you are a little bit draggy this morning. It's okay. I want you to turn to someone next to you and just say good morning, and this is the important part, try to force a smile when you do it, all right? Go for it. Good morning. All right. Excellent. All right, if you look in your bulletins, you'll see some announcements. I encourage you to read those. Today is a deadline for Christmas poinsettias, okay? So please turn those in if you're planning on getting some poinsettias. WMU monthly meeting, remember to read about that. And also, we need Richmond County Salvation Army bell ringing volunteers. The sign-up sheet is on Joanne's desk there in the office, so be sure to sign up that. As far as prayer requests, new ones on the back of your bulletins. Rudy Broderson, recovering at home from heart issues. The family of Christopher Pearson, Danny's nephew. John Shropshire is recovering at home. Still doing well? Good, good. Add Jim Kenner, K-E-N-N-E-R, did he have surgery Friday? How did it go?
It went well.
Good. So that's Andrew and Cindy's friend. Pray for him as he's in ICU recovering. Now, many of you have prayer requests too. Okay. And how many of you saw family this week that you don't normally see? Okay, half the hands went back down. Family are they have their own prayer request category, right? Folks that are close to our hearts. So let's go to the Lord now and take whatever worries, whatever concerns you have, and let's bring them to the Lord. Lord, I pray that you would please be with these worries on our hearts. Pray especially for those we know so well, those that we grew up with, those that we've known for our lives, and sometimes there's some deep concern there too, with members of our own family or good friends. I pray that you would be in these certain situations that concern us and grieve us. Lord, I pray right now that you be with Barbara Brown as she is traveling her last mile here on this side of glory. I pray that you'd be with Molly and her family. And Father, I pray that you would be with us. We have physical needs. We also have spiritual and emotional needs. I pray that this morning you would close the distance between us, the felt distance. Maybe you haven't gone anywhere, but we have drifted and we have been distracted by many, many things. And maybe you don't feel as close to us as we once knew. That's our faults. Maybe we have sin in our hearts, or maybe we're just so busy that we don't stop to think of you. I pray that this morning you would meet us where we are and we would meet you where you are in our hearts. You speak, Lord, and accept our worship. Christ we pray, amen. Thank you. Let's stand and sing At the Cross.
At the cross, at the cross. Let all that I am praise the Lord. With my whole heart, I will praise his holy name.
Let all that I am praise the Lord. May I never forget the good things he does for me.
He forgives all my sins and heals all my diseases. He redeems me from death and crowns me with love and tender mercies.
The Lord is compassionate and merciful, slow to get angry, and filled with unfailing love.
He will not constantly accuse us, nor remain angry forever.
He does not punish us for all our sins. He does not deal harshly with us as we deserve.
For his unfailing love toward those who fear him is as great as the height of the heavens above earth.
He has removed our sins as far from us as the east is from the west. The Lord is like a father to his children, tender and compassionate to those who fear him.
But the love of the Lord remains forever with those who fear him. His salvation extends to the children's children of those who are faithful to his covenant, of those who obey his commandments.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Jesus, we pray, amen. Let's sing again about the reason why we can be so confident, the reason why we have any hope in our loving God. It's because of Jesus and what he did for us on the cross. Let's stand and sing together. When I survey the wondrous cross.
So much for everything you do for us. We owe you so much thanks. Thank you for our families. Thank you for our friends. Thank you for this church where we can come and worship your name. But most of all, thank you for this season, the Thanksgiving and Christmas season, when you sent your son to wash away our sins. Bless us and bless these offerings. We ask these things in your name. Amen.
Thank you.
All right, kids, come on up to the front for the children's message. All right, watch out. Back up. Back up. You're going to guess this easily. All right, let's see what's in here. Yeah, that's right. It's a rope. Yeah, it's a big rope, isn't it?
I was about to say a snake. A fake snake.
Not a snake, no. That would be my last Sunday, probably, if I brought a snake up here.
No, a toy snake.
No, it's a boat rope.
It is kind of like a boat rope, isn't it? It's called a line, yeah.
Kind of like I'm going fishing today.
Well, I want to tell you a story about Dean. Did any of you have Thanksgiving?
Yeah.
Did you eat lots?
Yeah.
Yeah, lots
yeah,
of stuff.
I did not eat much.
Were there any desserts?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Well,
I had ice cream pie.
Ice cream pie. Ooh. Well, I want to tell you a story about Dean, who was about your age. And at his Thanksgiving meal, whether it was cold outside or warm outside, all the cousins went outside to play a game. Every year, you know what the game was called?
What?
Tug of War.
Tug of War.
Have you ever heard of that?
We used to play that at A-Lake.
Yeah, well, they'd all get out there, and one group of cousins would get on one side of the line, and the other group of cousins would get on the other side. I know you want to do it now, but I got a hold of this rope. And one would pull this way, and one would pull that way. And Dean got out there. It was the first year his parents let him get out there and to do the tug of war, because it got a little bit harsh. I mean, people were really pulling, and sometimes they'd run over one another or fall down. But Dean got out there, and he pulled hard, so hard. Have you ever tried to lift something as hard as you possibly could? Dean did that. He pulled on that rope hard, and he wouldn't give up, even though he felt like his feet were sliding across the grass. And they were just kind of, at one point, the rope went up higher than he was, and he just kind of lifted up with it. And he would not let go of that rope. And when it was all done, the other side won. His cousins on the other side won and pulled him across the line. But, you know, they all told him afterwards, Dean, You were trying hard. You were all into the tug of war. Wow. You would not give up. He said, I was never going to give up. I was just going to keep on pulling. Well, that's how we follow Jesus. We want to do it. We want to follow Jesus as best we can, to try as hard as we can, to never give up. Because did Jesus give up on us on the cross?
No.
He went all the way as far as he possibly could go, even dying for us, because he wouldn't give up on us, and we're not going to give up on him. So let's pray to him now. Let's pray to God. Let's close our eyes and bow our heads. Lord, I pray that you would just help us give you our all, to follow you as best we can, and to work as hard as we can. In the name of Jesus, amen. Thank you. Take your Bibles out. Hope you brought them this morning to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, starting in verse 11. In the Pew Bibles, it's page 966. Second Corinthians 5:11. Therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we persuade others, but what we are is known to God, and I hope it's known also to your conscience. We are not commending ourselves to you again, but giving you cause to boast about us, so that you may be able to answer those who boast about outward appearance and not about what is in the heart. Verse 13. For if we're beside ourselves, it's for God. If we are in our right mind, it is for you. For the love of Christ controls us, because we have concluded this, that one has died for all. Therefore, all have died. And he died for all, and those that live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who for their sake died and was raised. Lord God, open your word to our hearts, including me. Jesus, we pray. Amen. Those of you who are on the church Facebook page know that this has been one of those sermons for me. I've been wrestling with it quite a bit, and all the way down to this morning, wrestling with it. And just difficult to understand exactly how this is coming together. And I come to the conclusion that I needed to stop worrying about what God wanted to say to all of you and to realize that he wants to talk to me, that this applies to me first. I guess the Lord could have sent you anyone as a pastor. He could have sent you someone who is far advanced in the ways of Jesus or a scholar, but he sent you me instead, someone who is on the pilgrim road and falling down, and I need to hear my own sermons most of the time, all the time. This morning's one of those mornings, so forgive me if I preach to myself, but I find that when I preach to myself, the Lord sometimes finds an open door to preach to you too. So what is Paul saying here? He's always saying a lot. I guess I'll start out by sharing something that one of you told me over breakfast last Sunday, one of my friends here at church, who grew up with his grandparents, lived with his grandparents. And his grandfather especially did a great deal for him, taught him much of what he knows, was a father figure to him. And this man, when he was a little boy in grade school, got in trouble and was sent to the principal's office. And there in the principal's office, he sat down, and the principal was behind the desk, and the lady who was a principal took that old heavy rotary phone that was on her desk, pulled it close to herself, and just kind of had a finger on that phone. And this boy said, What are you gonna do? She said, well, I'm gonna call your grandparents, is what I'm gonna do for what you've done. And the boy just broke down. Please, no, anything. I'll scrub the courtyard with a toothbrush. I'll mow the grass with scissors. I mean, whatever you want to make me do, whatever punishment, fine, just don't call my grandparents. And, you know, you would think that the poor child maybe was afraid of being beaten within inches of his life when he got home. Or he said, no, it wasn't that at all. I didn't think I was going to be abused. In fact, I could only remember maybe two times in my whole life my grandpa ever took a switch out with me. He said, the thought of walking that long drive, road home there and seeing his disappointed face just tore me up. It was horrifying to even contemplate that. What did he fear his grandfather? Yes, but love defined that fear. Love defined that fear. He was afraid not of being harshly punished or abused or misunderstood or unloved. You're no grandson of mine anymore. He was afraid of offending or disappointing the love that his grandfather had showed him. Something of what Paul is feeling here when he says in verse 11, therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord. And anytime you see a word like therefore, it's referring to something right before it. And right before it in verse 10, Paul's very mindful. He said, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ so that each one may receive what is due for what he's done in the body, whether good or evil. Paul realizes that he's going to have to face Jesus face to face, fully. No excuses, no cover-ups, no mask, no dodges. And give an account for everything he has done or hasn't done. And the thought that he might disappoint Jesus is so sobering, it slaps him in the face. It makes him fearful. Not that Jesus is going to say, you're no brother of mine. Forget it. I would have never gone to the cross if I'd known you were going to be such a sorry Christian. He's not afraid of that. He's afraid that he might not love Jesus like Jesus has showed love for him. He loves Jesus so much, he is afraid of disappointing him. Therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we persuade others. Now Paul's thinking about his own life. The fear isn't that somebody else is messed up and need fixing. The fear is that he might be a hypocrite, that he might make a wrong turn and when he sees Jesus face to face, all that's going to be brought in the open. The principal has called, you know, and he's going to have to face that. He says, therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we persuade others, but what we are is known of God, and I hope it is known also to your conscience. And this is what the Lord lays on my plate first here. Maybe you need it too. With Jesus, you only have to fear one thing. So if you are in Jesus, if you really have given your life to Jesus as he has given his life for you, anybody unashamed to say, I'm the Lord's? Anyone else besides this young man here, unashamed to say, I'm a follower of Jesus Christ. Okay? You could be afraid of a lot of things. You could be afraid of where this world is going and the world events that you see every day. You could be afraid because of things you've done in the past. You could be afraid of some kind of pain that you may be facing, or afraid that someone you love might not know Jesus. But there's all that pales in comparison to the one thing that you need to be concerned about more than anything else: being a hypocrite. With Jesus, you only have to fear one thing: being a hypocrite. Now listen to Paul in these first verses, 11 through 13. Knowing the fear of the Lord, we persuade others, but what we are is known of God. You know, let him search your heart right now. What are you? Not what role is your name on, not what do your parents think of you, how many friends do you have, or what tax bracket you're in, or where do you work? No, who are you known by God? When you see Jesus face to face, and he sees you for who you really are, who are you known by God? And I hope it is known also to your conscience. You know, you're really not going to be able to... Paul knew that he couldn't hide who he really was from those who knew him best. I may think that I can hide who I really am, but who I really am is going to come to light to those I know best, right? Sometimes people go and they fool other people for years and years, but it comes out in the open eventually, right? Most of the time, those that love us and those who know us best, we're upset with them sometimes because they actually know who we really are. They blow our cover. With Paul, there was no cover. There was just who he really is. And he could stand in good conscience before his church family as well. Verse 12, we're not commending ourselves to you again, but giving you cause to boast about us, so that you may be able to answer those who boast about outward appearance and not what's in the heart. You hear what Paul's occupied with here? It's who he really is, through and through. He's not a super Christian. He's not a super apostle. He doesn't like have it all together and nobody else does. He's not putting on a show. It's who he really is. Years ago, I resisted technology for a long time. I resisted getting a smartphone. I resisted Facebook. I resisted Instagram, all that stuff. Finally, someone from my church got all over me and said, Keith, to really connect with your people, you need to go online. You need to do these things. And I'm somewhat of a Luddite. I'm someone who lives in the past, didn't want to do it. I finally did it. And I remember going on Facebook for the first time and seeing my church members and what they were posting, the people that I thought I knew. And I went through, and I was shocked sometimes to read some of the comments, some of the posts. I was like, do they not know that their pastor might be online seeing what they're saying? Seeing the pictures that they're putting on here? Paul didn't have a social media persona that was different from who he is before God. He wasn't perfect. He considered himself the chief of all sinners, but one thing he wasn't, a hypocrite. That was the one thing that spooked him, the one thing that he was afraid of more than anything else. Now, other people, the ministry competitors, they saw themselves as competitors to Paul. They were all about being impressive, impressing people, acting like they knew it all and they had it all together. Paul calls them those who boast about outward appearance. Paul resolved himself, I'm not going to be one of those. I'm not going to be a hypocrite. I'm just going to be who I am. And if people think I'm nuts, if people think I'm crazy, fine. I'm crazy for Jesus. I'm crazy for Christ. He says in verse 13, for if we're beside ourselves, it's for God. And if we're in our right mind, it's for you. He's not doing it to impress anyone. I remember when I first was checking out the house, that we live in now and had a building inspector come and check it out before we bought it. And he only brought one tool with him, a pocket knife. And boy, he went to business with that pocket knife on that house. All the freshly painted trim on the outside, he'd take out that little pocket knife, and he went pokey, 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 just poking all around. What was he doing? He knew what it looked like on the outside had nothing to do with what that wood's condition truly was. He was checking for decay. He was checking to see where the termites been. Where's the rot been? What is this new paint covering up? Remember, he went into the bathroom. And there was a little stain in the drywall. He took that pocket knife and he started poking the ceiling with it. He goes, oh, it just went, whoop, went right through. He goes, oh, we got a leak here. You know, went on. I wonder if we just let the Lord kind of check our lives out, not the varnished, whitewashed exterior of our lives, our cover, our persona, our Christian Oscar-winning performance that we put on at church or around our grandparents or whoever. But if the Spirit began to probe more deeply of who we really are, what would be found? I challenge you to look at any of the four Gospels, the accounts of Jesus' life in the Bible. Anybody know what the four Gospels are? Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. Every single one of those stories, those accounts of Jesus' life, we find Jesus getting upset. We find Jesus helping and loving people. We find Jesus who he really is across the whole spectrum of human experience and divine experience. There is one group of people that stands out as the people that irritated Jesus more than anything, any other people. The people that he had the harshest words for, the only people that he condemned. It was not the immoral people of his day. It wasn't the people in the opposite political party. It wasn't the people who were living sinful lifestyles. It wasn't the Roman collaborators. It wasn't a particular gender or a socioeconomic group or a racial group. You know who it was, right? The religious hypocrites. The people who believed just like he did, or at least they said they did, and yet the ones that were frauds, charlatans, putting up a front of impressive, holier-than-thou credentials, and then really just below the surface, Jesus described it in picturesque terms as only he could. He described these people as whitewashed tombs. You know, they look great and beautiful on the outside, like monuments to their holiness, and inside they're full of decaying bones. He described them as a nice cup, a clean cup that was washed on the outside, and inside there's just rottenness. He was talking about the word that we now call hypocrite. Paul was afraid. Lord, don't let me be a hypocrite. Now, there's a prayer that God can answer in my heart and in your life. Now, I may not have it all together. I may not know it all. I may not have gifts like someone else, but I can be Keith Williams, saved by Jesus Christ, loved by Almighty God, simply be authentically who I am, a sinner saved by grace following Jesus. Amen? And you can be who you are. And when you see Jesus face to face, you won't have a bunch of explaining to do because you've already been living honestly, openly, transparently before him. I'm reminded of the words of that old Negro spiritual. I want to be a Christian in my heart. You ever heard that? I want to be a Christian in my heart, in my heart. Lord, I want to be a Christian in my heart, in my heart, in my heart. Lord, I want to be a Christian in my heart. Goes on, I want to be more loving. I want to be more holy. And the last, my favorite, I want to be like Jesus. In my heart, in my heart, I want to be like Jesus in my heart. In my heart, in my heart, I want to be like Jesus in my heart. I'm convinced that whoever came up with those words didn't have a seminary degree. It's just too true for that. I'm convinced that whoever came up with those words wasn't a preacher. It's just too real and too honest for good preaching. But I'm convinced that whoever came up with those words may have been someone picking cotton, may have been someone working in the house, may have been someone at church, but whoever came up with those words knew what following Jesus was all about, and they could strike one fear off their mind, the fear of being a hypocrite. Do you want to be a Christian in your heart? Or do you just want to be a Christian on the roll? Do you want to be a Christian in your heart? Or do you just want to be a Christian in your family heritage? Do you want to be a Christian in your heart? Or do you want to be a Christian in your political ideology? Do you want to be a Christian and be honored at your funeral and have some nice eulogies about you and hear things maybe from heaven like, well, he was always helping other people, or she was always such a loving person? Or do you want to see Jesus face to face and say, well, I may not have had much and I may not have done much, but what I am, you know, and what I am is someone who loves you, Jesus. I am a Christian in my heart. Is that you? If it's not you, then you haven't even begun to be a Christian. I haven't even begun to be a preacher. We haven't even begun to be a child of God until He comes in to our hearts in truth. Therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we persuade others. But what we are is known of God. Then we have verses 14 and 15. Isn't it about time for you to give Christ's love complete control? Go all in. Go all in. How many of you have ever coached a sports team of any kind? Amen. I have too. The kids are nothing compared to the parents. Amen. Reggie, can I get a witness? Yeah. In fact, Reggie, just as a total aside, Reggie gave me some of the best advice I'd ever heard. He said, you know, those parents come to me and they're giving me a hard time or whatever, and I just say, thank you for bringing that to my attention. And I have used that in ministry. It is a powerful response. And Reggie was the first one I used it on. But if you've ever been a coach, or you've had one, or you've overheard one, you'll at some point hear these words. Your head's not in the game. You're just not in the game. Come on. Earth to Dean, Earth to Bill, Earth to Sue. Come on, let's get with it here. Let's get our head in the game. Let's go all in. Paul is all in. Now, he may be a lot of things, We may accuse him of a lot of things. We may even call him crazy, but the man is committed. He is all in. Look at verses 14 and 15. For the love of Christ controls us, because we have concluded this, that one has died for all, therefore all have died. And he died for all, and those who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who for their sake died and was raised. Whole gospel's here. The whole program for Christian living is right here. The whole sermon is right here. He talks about the one overriding influence or awareness in his life that he's concerned about more than anything else. He starts verse 14 with it. What does he say? The love of Christ. Remember, that's why I said that Christian fear is defined by love. Because Paul has said that he knows the fear of the Lord, but it's defined by love here as he's still talking about the fear of God, and he says, the love of Christ controls us, controls me. The word in Greek is something that presses in on you. From all sides, you can't escape it. It constrains you. It directs you. It motivates you. As he goes through his day and he decides what his schedule is going to be or what his priority is going to be or whether he's going to talk to somebody or be quiet or how he's going to spend his money or what decision he's going to make for the new year. And all those things, the love of Christ controls him. The love of Christ constrains him. It's all about the love of Christ and its complete control over his life. And how does he know about the love of Christ? Because one died for all of us, he says. He could look at Jesus and see the love of God, the overpowering love of God just poured out in its fullness in Jesus. And he knows, by putting that word all, that he's including himself in that number. He knows that God loved him so much, the chief of all sinners, the one who didn't deserve another chance. He knows that God loved even him, and he loves even you. He loves even me. I don't care who you are, or how great you think you are, or how lowly you think you are. The love of Christ controls this. The love of Christ has the last word. The love of Christ was given when Jesus died on the cross, not as a haphazard tragedy, not as a random act of violence, not as yet another human injustice, but the purpose of love of God poured out for you and for me. It controls me. It has taken possession of our lives. And yet that's not me. That's not me. I often try to follow Jesus from a distance. And I know none of you may do this, but I'm reminded of Peter. After the Garden of Gethsemane, when Jesus was arrested and he was being hauled off to trial, it says in Mark 14:54 that Peter followed him from a distance. You know, to get any closer to Jesus might be risky. Might have to give up something. Might be embarrassing. It might be dangerous. But Peter still wanted to follow Jesus, so he just followed him from a distance. And what did that get him? In the courtyard, as Jesus was on trial at the high priest's house, he ended up denying that he even knew Jesus three times. Amen? Sometimes we don't go all in because we'd rather follow Jesus from a safe distance. Sometimes We believe in Jesus from a distance. We believe in Jesus like I believe that there are the great pyramids of Giza in Egypt. I've never seen them personally. I think my parents took a trip there. They saw them. They told me about it. I've never seen the pyramids, but I believe they're there. Anybody else believe that there are pyramids in Egypt? Okay, good, good. Yeah, and what does that have to do with the price of tea in China? Did that have any effect on your life this week? None. Zero. I haven't even thought about the pyramids until I got this sermon together and tried to think of an example of some fact, some belief I have that had no practical, relevant intersection with my real life. Oh, pyramids of Giza, that foots the bill. That's what Jesus is like for us sometimes. Do you believe in Jesus? Oh, yes. Oh, yes, I believe in Jesus. I believe he died for me. I believe he raised from the dead. And then we live our lives. And there's no practical intersection between the cross and real life. We believe in Jesus from a distance. And sometimes, now this is the big one for me. Sometimes I'm kept at a distance from Jesus and I'm not all in and my head's not in the game because there are just so many distractions in my life. I mean, really, anybody else know about distractions? For me, there is no verse of Scripture in the words of Jesus that are more convicting than when he described in Matthew chapter 13, verse 22, I think it is, talks about seed being sown in a field and some of it falls over by the thorns. And he said, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of this world. Anybody worried about anything? Nobody? Nobody? Okay. I'm worried, very worried. The cares of this world and the deceitfulness of riches. How many of you are concerned about what you got? Anybody? Okay, good. Five people, that's good. The deceitfulness of riches choke the word and it proves unfruitful. Now, there is a good description of my life sometimes. I believe in Jesus from a distance, not because I doubt that he died on the cross, not because I haven't trusted myself to him, but because I'm just looking at everything else and I'm worshiping everything else and I'm worried about everything else and I'm desiring other things more than Jesus. And so the love of Christ does not control me. Those things do. In the last couple of years, I have noticed in the news the same kind of story. I don't know if it's always happened a lot or if it's happening a whole lot more these days. It seems like it's happening more. Ever read a story about squatters? I'm not talking about squatting. I'm talking about someone who has a house or an apartment somewhere, and let's say they go on vacation or something, and they come back and they find out that somebody's moved in. They're not paying rent. They have no legal right to be there, but they're squatting. They're there and they ain't leaving. And sometimes the law will not even intervene to make them leave, right? They're squatting. Maybe they claim that you came up with some kind of agreement with them. You know, I don't think squatting's a big thing in the Northern Neck, because the outcome of that confrontation might be a little different here than it is on the left coast. I'm not sure. I read a news story about these squatters and I think, what in the world is going on there? That's crazy. That would never happen in my house. I mean, that person's leaving one way or another. They're leaving. And yet I look at my heart. This is property. My life is property. I am not my own. I have been bought by a price, with a price, the price of the blood of Jesus on the cross. This is not my life. This is God's life. in me, and yet I look in my heart and my life, and you got squatters all over the place. These worries I've got, they just moved in. They're trashing the place. They're getting in the way. Jesus, who owns me, cannot come in and fully live and work because I got squatters. I got things that I love. I got toys. I got money. I got property. I got worries. I have all these things. I got health issues. I got people that I'm concerned about. All that's good and well until it comes and moves in the apartment of my life and just illegally squats there. It's time for some things to get evicted. Amen? It's time, one way or another, to remove some things from your life. They may be things that you need to be worried about, but boy, don't let it get in Jesus' way. The love of Christ controls me. God owns me. What do I need to do? I need to let Him come in. It may be that evicting these squatters from my heart may take the shape of that I've been living a lie. I've been calling myself a Christian. I've been relying on some childhood memory that I'm not even sure what happened, if Jesus even came in my heart or if I ever really followed Him. Maybe I've just been saying, I believe in God. Yeah, my parents were Christians. But you're not a Christian in your heart. In your heart. And you don't even want to be a Christian in your heart. And today may be the time that Jesus shows up and evicts that unbelief and comes in for the first time. It may be that you called yourself a Christian and in your heart you want to be a Christian and you've never taken the first step of obedience, of just without shame saying, I am the Lord's. He owns me now by being baptized. And showing the world on the outside what Jesus has done on the inside. And it may be that the first squatter that needs to go is your reluctance and your procrastination with actually being baptized in the name of Jesus Christ that you say you believe in. Amen? For some of you, maybe the big squatter there is this hesitation to actually fully take part in a church family. This is a big thing in America, okay? We, as if we can just do things on our own. It's just me and Jesus. I'll just worship God at home. I'll just worship God in the woods. Or I'll show up to church anonymously, which is really difficult in the Northern Neck, but we try to do it anyway. We just show up and we sit in our pew and then we slip out and then that's just it. We say we're part of a church, but really we're not even engaged. We don't really know anyone. We're not really giving of ourselves. Well, I'm waiting till I find the right church. Let me know when that happens. You'll be dead in heaven when it happens, when you find the perfect church. Like I've said before, when you find the perfect church, by no, don't go there. You'll mess it all up. No, you need to find a church with a pastor who doesn't have it all together. That's all churches, but you need to find one with a pastor that's willing to admit it. You need to find a church with other people who don't have it all together. Now, nobody's got it all together, but you need to find some brothers and sisters who can help you on the journey and you can help them. Well, I just don't feel fed at church. Well, then maybe you need to feed somebody else at church. Amen? Maybe it's not about commending yourself. Maybe it's not about getting, and it's more about what Jesus wants to give through you. Amen? I done stopped preaching and got to meddling, as folks in Buckingham County would say. So what? The preaching is hitting here. It's time to go all in or just not even call yourselves Christians in the first place. There are only two levels of Christianity. You're not a Christian. You're not saved by the blood of Jesus. You're not His. That's one group. And then there's the group that you're all in. You're a part of living your life and growing with Jesus. That's the call to me. That's the call to you through Paul this morning. It's time to get your head in the game. It's time to do what you say you believe. The love of Christ controls us, constrains us, enables us, challenges us, comforts us. Father God, do what you want in me. Father God, there's someone here maybe who's been talking about with you what they need to do and they've never done it. May today be the day they get serious. May today be the day they go all in. May today be the day that they experience the love of Jesus Christ in all its fullness as they simply take a baby step towards you and find you waiting for them. We're yours. That's all there is to it. Save us from hypocrisy. In Christ we pray, amen. Let's stand as we sing. From the heart, living for Jesus.
Thank you.
Now, Father God, I pray for those who have already embraced you as their Lord and Savior. They already have believed in Jesus. We've already been baptized and we're part of a church family. But Lord, we find that we've drifted. We've drifted in the meantime. We've gotten cooler in our commitment. We give ourselves afresh to you today. We find you waiting for us as we want to renew our old enthusiasm, our old commitment. We want to put our heads in the game. We want to give you our all. Help us where we are to do that. You know how distracting our lives are. Help us to live for you in those lives. Thank you for the blessing of Jesus that will overcome all these obstacles. Thank you that you will finish what you started in me and in us. Thank you for the hope of glory, where forever and ever we will be yours and you will be ours. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.